Many times we like to point fingers, forgetting that there are more fingers pointing back at us than we have at the person. Whether or not you want to call it pot or kettle or beam in your eye versus the mote in your neighbor's. But we have somebody who's calling us that kind of introspection. His name is Roderick Gordon, Mr. Chuck.
Yes, sir.
Chuck Gordon.
Yeah,
good morning, sir. How you doing?
Good morning, brother.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me. All is well?
We're doing.
What's
about?
It's about our complacency as a Trinidad society and overlooking simple values and simple virtues that I think often leads to bigger challenges. And it's really, as you rightly suggested, us taking the time out for some kind of reflection, introspection, and understanding what we can do differently to contribute to society. Because for me, everything is connection. I mean, one thing leads to the next, one value begets the other. So if we start to understand that and take individual responsibility for every action, for every step, for every thought, I think that's the only way we can really start to generate the kind of movement to create a better society.
What kind of response are you getting?
Very good, guys. Very good thus far. Just up to last night, I had a rousing response. You know, I tried a new verse in the tent. You know, that's the tradition of the Calypso tent, and it went down well, you know. So we're looking forward to a good couple of weeks moving forward.
Wait, you're with Kaiser House. Who are some of the other people in the tent this year?
Yeah, well, let me say from the onset, excellence is a tradition at Kaiser House.
Just put it out.
Yeah, let me just put that one time. Yeah. Quickens it. We have singing Sandra, the only female to have won the Calypso Monarch on two occasions. Brother Valentino, he has a big number to say. People like Explainer, Karina Shea, former Calypso Monarch, Dwayne O'Connor as well. Exposer, Poser, Charlon Bailey, the Son of Shadow, Spicy, The Diamond, and the list goes on. You have a large cast and a varied cast, because you have a lot of young people as well, like Jumani Cox. We have Ghetto Flex there, he goes by the name Hilton Dazzle, now doing the soca thing, closing off the show. So we have a large cast, and I think it's very diverse, and I'm seeing people coming to the tent and leaving very much satisfied.
Where's the tent this year?
Globe Cinema, Corner Park and St. Vincent Street.
Okay, because I know sometimes you had to watch and see where it is. Okay, it's not in the Savannah anymore.
Yeah. Well, last year we had the Savannah opposite Napa, but this year we had Globe. And I mean, it's a space I really enjoy performing at. It's a full theatre space, so the atmosphere, the ambience, everything is conducive to a good sound and good performance. So come down to Kaiser House nightly. Let me say it again. Excellence is a tradition. It's the vibes.
What you're doing is not the only song, it's not the only offering you have for this year. What else?
Well, I have the Rumble in the Jungle, which is the Supernova's theme song. Last year we did well with a second placing with a breakthrough. This year we're Rumbling in the Jungle. It's the story of Suri Village, with the community from which the Supernova Steel Orchestra hail. And Amrit Samru, Mark Lokwan came together to produce this one. And of course, they asked me to vocalize again, given the success of last year's song. So that's one, Rumble in the Jungle. There's a video for that also on YouTube. And also the Groovy Soca Monarch, I participated in on Sunday. The results are due to come out later tonight. Hoping for the best. I have one called Do Let Go. It's a Groovy Soca song that was produced in Barbados by the Red Boys.
What is the attraction of the Red Boys this one? Because it's sometimes it feels as though you're not doing anything right now unless you check the Red Boys.
Well, I think what Red Boys do, first and foremost, is they ensure that they like a song. So when you engage them initially and you send your demo, as the case may be, they ask you if they're not fully in agreement with the product, they ask you to make changes and come back again. Following that, they pay a lot of attention to detail. So even the 3-4 days you may spend in Barbados, it's a structured, ordered process that they engage in. And that adds now to the quality, because in terms of song engineering and sound production, garbage in is garbage out. And if you don't put in the work initially, you can never get a good product. And once that standard is set, they take about 2 to 3 months on a song, you know, given the time availability. And they really put in a lot of work on a song. So you hear it reflected and represented in the song quality. So which is why every Red Boys track, I think, is playable. You know, at least it gets some level of rotation. At least it's familiar to the ears and it's something that could last and live on. And that has been my experience with them thus far, working for them for the past 4 to 5 years.
And what does it mean for soca music in, from the Caribbean in general when you have this kind of movement across the islands and this interface?
Well, I mean, it's good. We need to share the culture because we have, I think, similar experiences, similar type structured carnivals and festivities, you know, so everybody comes with their own unique influence and taste, and the Red Boys gives you a real authentic soca song, where a lot of our producers locally have decided to go the EDM route or the less conventional soca route. So I think the islands helps to remind us locally of who we are and what we have. And that communication amongst the islands really, really works in terms of sharing and in terms of, you know, being product oriented as well, because we are Caribbean people and Caribbean music is popular music that the world needs to hear. It's new popular music to the world. And I think we could, once we have the product properly developed, we could sell that. And Red Boys is assisting in that process.
New popular music.
Mm-hmm.
What does a pan side playing a different me mean for the industry, especially in terms of saying, okay, well, this doesn't need to be a pan song as opposed to a song that we play on the pan?
Well, it kind of harks back to what it used to be when there was an intermarriage between pan, calypso, and soca. I always make the point that late 70s, 80s, one song could have won you, the March, the Road March, the Panorama, the Young Kings in one. You know, so all aspects of our art form were aligned to each other, and there wasn't the separation that we have seen in the past couple of years. You know, so I think it's a step in the right direction in terms of people coming to the Panorama and feeling that they're hearing familiar music and music that they are, that they've been embedded or in indoctrinated into them, so to speak, during the Carnival season. So it's really a step in the right direction, and we've seen the success of it with Desperados now coming this year. We have about 5 or 6 bands doing Good Morning, another Red Boys production, Connection again. We have the Full Extreme doing well. And I mean, even Amrit in Supernovas attempting to be different. We attempted to create a song and a track that could live up to the party atmosphere.
Well, let's listen to some of that now. And,
yeah, yeah.
And hopefully we can get it again. So, well, yeah, while they recue it. But what is the relationship between Amrit, Supernovas, yourself? What's the attraction?
Well, last year he suggested to me that when his dad was at his height, when he won 8 Panoramas, he was doing a lot of Kitchener music. There was a marriage again between the artist, the Calypsonian, and the pan side. And that is the movement that we are attempting to create, which is why we're trying to create the visual as well, and attach to the song. We have a video out as well. So it's about the understanding that the Calypsonian, the pan man, we are part of the same landscape, and we need to work together in terms of driving the music and the agenda forward. And that people could see the relationship and feel the impact of it. So that is in fact purposeful on Amrit's part.
All right, well let us let people see and hear and get that tangible sense as we play just a little piece of Wet Appetite of the song Rumble in the Jungle. We do that now.
Yeah, man.
It's exciting, and the forest is seen.
Boom!
Cricket chirping, keep the timing. Then the band kick with their music to blow your mind. Performing in joy and splendor. I start to move like I don't have no behavior. Music from left to right, spitting fire just for spite. They light up the jungle night.
Full flight!
We hear it.
So we invite you to get a little more familiar with the song Rumble in the Jungle.
Yeah, man. It'll be a rumble in the savannah on Sunday.
When people looking at songs for pan and they're looking for the amount of chords and things that they can do with it, Do you find that there's a dearth sometimes? Because I think I say that not trying to throw shade or anything, but when you look at something that has three or four chords,
right,
and then you look at something like The Urge, yeah, that has about 12 chords inside,
yeah,
the thing.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's up to the arranger. At the end of the day, just yesterday I was having this conversation with a guy from the National Steel Orchestra, and I was saying, what will make the difference between a Renegades, a Starleaf, a Desperados playing the same song? He says, all subject to the interpretation of the arranger and how well he's able to use what little he has, or as much as he has, and create something different and a different sound. It may work for you, having to do the same song that many other bands are doing, and it might work against you, but it's always on the interpretation. You know, so the initial song, as you suggested, may have three, four chords. In terms of your variation and your improvisations, what are you going to do differently? So it's all about the arranger. That's the magic there, boy.
You point your head, and I want to ask, which hat do you prefer wearing the most? Is it for stuff like pan, soca, calypso?
I enjoy wearing all hats, which is one hat. I consider myself, and I like to speak about, you know, the artist who are able to do party music, who are able to do music with melodies, who were also able to do music with lyrics and substance and conscious building material, or nation building material, as it were. That is in the tradition of all our great artists. I'm not saying that I'm a great, but that is the tradition that, that's the tradition that I've chosen to follow. And I mean, it takes a lot of internalization, a lot of skill, a lot of work in terms of being able to represent different types of material well. But that's the direction that I've chosen, and it's one hat for me, because as an artist, or as a calypsonian, or as a soca artist, you ought to be able to reflect different types of material, which is essentially a representation of your society and where we are and who we are.
On that path, what determines who you partner with? Because one of the songs that I really liked the last year was No Time to Think.
Oh God, yeah, man.
And so in terms of like both the vocals of the Fridge, as well as the art of Alexander from Red Engine.
That's right. Yeah. Well, I mean, it depends on the song and what was the particular feel I'm looking for. That production was done with Julian Nelson, former Road March winner. He produced Super Blue, Super Blues, Fantastic Friday about 3 years ago. So Julio has a soulful kind of energy about him when he's producing. You know, everybody has a different energy. For example, what you're doing is a Ray Holman arrangement. Although it is lyrical, substance-based, and it has a nation-building theme, the melody is beautiful. And I mean, we have conversations about this all the time, and Ray also suggests that a great song starts with a great melody. I mean, No Time to Think for me is it didn't get the just due that a lot of people felt it ought to deserve, but melodies are really important, and that's the focus. So a lot of the great artists you would have found work with arrangers who could give you a different style, a different touch, a different flavor, and it's a collaborative process moving forward.
And I heard that actually Kitchener used to build the melody and then work backwards. We put lyrics on it after.
Exactly, yeah.
But we want to thank you for your presence, man. And hopefully everything that you put your hands to gets us just due this time around.
Yeah, man.
And big things for you this
year.
Thank you so much.
Brother.